I start, I want to honor God. He is so awesome. And it's only him that I am standing here today. And I also want to honor Pastor Micah and the whole RSM leadership team. I just really honor you guys. I really don't tell you guys that much, but I really honor you guys just for the work that, the anointing that is on your life, and just the work that you guys have did important to me. And lastly, the Bible says, honor thy mother and father, and I want to honor my mother and my dad that are here today. Okay, so you guys can get your Bibles, and I want you guys to jump to 1 Kings 19. And if you guys don't have it in the next 5 seconds, I'm going to read it for you. All right. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, also how he had executed all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah, saying, "So let the gods do to me, and more also, if I do not make your life as the life of one new by tomorrow about this time." And when he saw that, he arose and ran for his life and went to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah, and left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat under a broom tree. And he prayed that he might die and said, "It is enough. Now, Lord, take my life, for I am no better than my father's." We're going to jump down to verse 9. And there he went into a cave, and he spent the night in that place. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" So he said, "I have been very zealous for you, Lord, God of hosts, for the children of Israel have forsaken your covenant, tore down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I am alone left, and they seek to take my life." We're going to jump down to verse 12. And after the earthquake, the fire. But the Lord was not in the fire, and after the fire, a still small voice. So it was when Elijah heard it that he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood in the entrance of the cave. Suddenly a voice came to him and said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" I just want to talk to you guys about something that the Lord has been doing in me. Before coming back for my second year, I was so excited, ministry training, preaching lab, hermeneutics class, preaching in chapel. Then I get in Pastor Casey class, which is hermeneutics, and preaching lab. And then I found out that I really didn't know if I was called or not. So I said, Lord, you done brought me all the way up in here to Hamilton, Alabama, in the middle of nowhere. I leave college, come here, and I'm not called. I said, something's going on here. So after that, I leave out, y'all. It was so bad, I went to my mama. I called my mama. I was like, "Mom, I'm packing up in my bags." I was like, "I don't know if my roommate comes here. I'm coming back to Georgia." I was like, "Because I misheard God." So I'm crying, y'all, for a couple of days. I'm eating, overeating. I'm getting depressed. I'm scared. I was like, "God, what is going on?" Like, I'm not called. And I remember there was a sense of fear that came on me. And it may sound dramatic, but it was for the place of like, "God, if I'm not of the will of God, like you brought me here and you forsaken me, like, I don't know what's going on, God. Like, I feel like I am in a danger zone." Like, it sounds very dramatic, but that's where I was. I'm like, "God, I'm in a danger zone. Like, you brought me here. Then for me to feel like that I'm not called," I was like, what am I doing here? So, the Lord reminded me of a story back in 5th grade. Now, before I start, this is not a sad story, so don't start. But I was 265 in the 5th grade. I was very obese. And so, I was known as a church kid where I was. They had me singing in class. They had me praise dancing, doing "Now Behold the Lamb," all that stuff. And so, one day, this thug came. I mean, he was from the hood. And so he started bullying me. Pastor Mike, he started bullying me. Calling me names. I mean, for a couple of days, I was like, okay, I was very intimidated.
That's really funny.
I was like, okay, I don't know what to do because I wasn't really, known for fighting or whatever. And so I remember, just getting fed up one day. I remember getting fed up one day because it was to the point where I didn't want to go to school. I was acting like I was sick. I just was very fearful and intimidated. But I remember the Lord had gave me a clear word back in the third grade that I was going to be the first male on my mother's side in the family to not only graduate high school, but to graduate from college. I was going to be a game changer. So there was a fear and an intimidation that was pushing me in a cave when God had called me to do something. So I was like, Lord, well, I didn't ask the Lord, but I got fed up. And so I fought him. Well, it was more like one push, she went down, and he was just trying to have a problem with him again. And so I began to think about this. Many of you are like me. You have came to RSM. The Lord has called you here, and there has been a fear on you. There has been a fear on you, a fear. Maybe your fear is rejection. Maybe your fear is being hurt. Maybe you have a fear of man. But I heard the Lord say, what are you doing here? He said, where are you at RSM? He said, where are you at the first class, first year, second class? He said, I haven't called you to come in a cave. He said, I haven't called you to sit back to run and hide. And God said, I haven't called you to sit on the forefront. And he said, I am not calling you to sit in this cave. And so I was like, Lord, how do we fight back? And he reminded me of 2 Timothy, the 1st and the 7th verse. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. A lot of times we come in church and we hear about, we have, you know, the same spirit that lives with us, raised Jesus Christ from the dead. The same, we got resurrection power. We can be very religious with that because you don't really understand what you're saying. If you walk in fear, that is impossible for you to have the power. If you have power on the inside of you, why are you fearing? Because God has already equipped you every fear, every obstacle. God has already equipped you with the power, with the anointing, with the grace to overcome every fear, every devil in hell. The Bible says, stay there till you be endued with power. And once you have power, I have given you power to tread upon lions, scorpions, serpents. He has given you all type of problems. So why are you fearing? Why are we fearing? I think we really have the realization of even our identity or what God has given us or the grace that he has given us and the anointing that he has given us. And the second thing it said of love. Now it says perfect love casts out. Perfect love casts out. Perfect love casts out all fear. So in the scripture of Elijah, we see there was a certain point in time before he went to the cave that an angel had to come to him and remind him to eat. Anytime you're not reading your word, anytime you not have an appetite for the things of God, a hunger, a spirit for prayer and fasting, you are open to a spirit of fear. And anytime you are dealing with fear, and let me tell you, where God is, fear cannot stay. So the only thing that you have to do is get in the presence of God. It's impossible for fear to live where God is living at. It's impossible. So the only thing that you have to do is get in the presence of God. And so, power, a love, and a sound mind. Elijah was wavering in his faith. We cannot be double-minded. We have to, the Bible says, faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of God. But there's one more verse that I want to tell you guys. I want you guys to go to Revelation 12 and 11. Yeah. And it says, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. But listen to this. And they did not love their lives to death. Elijah ran for his life. He loved his life too much. If you're going to overcome any fear, there has to be a fearful warrior that comes on the inside of you, a boldness. A boldness. So when you begin to fight that spirit of fear, when you begin to combat it, you can't love your life. God is calling us to become fearful, fearless, and dangerous in the kingdom of God. The Bible says that the violent take it by force. And the Bible says also any man that love his life or try to save his life, lose it. But any man that loses his life, gain his life. If there's anything that you, and this fear may be just like a giant in your life. It may be a Goliath. And I like David, this battle may not even be yours. It probably was your mama. Your mama probably dealt with fear. Generations before you probably dealt with fear. But I believe that there's some people in RSM saying that we're going to deal with fear of rejection, fear of being hurt. But I'm going to go on the battlefield just like David, and I'm going to conquer this giant. Because there's a boldness that comes on us. No longer will we hide in the back and try to run just like Adam did. No longer will we try to hide. But when it's time to pray, we'll stand up and pray because God is calling us.
place of prayer, a higher place of fasting, and a higher place in the kingdom. So I am telling you guys, come out of that cave. You've been in there a little bit too long. Come out of the cave. First year class, come out. Second year class, come out. And let's do the work that God has called us to do.
Come on, thank the Lord for that word.